Hello, my name is Guy de la Bedoyère, British historian and archaeologist, known to some of you because of the books I've written over the years and also because of my appearances on the British Archaeology TV series Time Team in the past. And you'll also be aware that I've got a wide range of other interests, probably including my book on Egypt, Pharaohs of the Sun, How Egypt's Despots and Dreamers Drove the Rise and Fall of Tutankhamun's Dynasty. This is the sixth proof. Some of you will be aware of the saga. This has been one of the most complicated projects I've ever been involved with. And I'm delighted to say that the book has now gone off to press as of the middle of May 2022. I've signed it off and it is now being printed, complete with this very spiffing cover, which I'm very pleased with, designed by Little Brown, although using a photograph I took at Karnak 10 years ago. So I'm very pleased with all that, delighted to say that it's gone off to be produced. So looking forward to that, although with great trepidation, as I know from experience as an author, that the first thing you do when you open a new book is find a mistake that you haven't seen during the whole production process, but that's just the way it is. But today what I'm going to talk to you about is the Lullingstone Roman Villa. Now, this is a subject very dear to my heart, and I revisited it recently with my granddaughter, and I am inspired, therefore, to talk to you about it today. The Lullingstone Roman Villa is probably the most interesting Roman villa in Britain. It's one of the most interesting sites of Roman date in Britain, and I first visited it around 50 years ago when my parents took me. I went down with my family and visited this extraordinary place. It's in northwest Kent, not very far from London, and it's very close to a junction with the M25 and the M20, and close to a village called Eynsford. And I will be putting some photographs up of the site at the end of this video so that you can see what it looked like. But first of all, I'm just going to talk to you generally about that experience. Now, Lullingstone is fascinating for a variety of reasons. If you listen to archaeologists telling you why they want to dig up a Roman villa, they'll normally say, well, we want to find out who lived here, what went on here, what sort of people lived in this place, how they lived, and so on. And, for example, the nature of the estate that supported the villa. And I've been involved with a few villa digs over the years. And, of course, the reality is that you never answer any of those questions. You just don't. No Roman villa in Britain was owned by someone we can name. We don't know anything about that. We have no estate books for a Roman villa in this country, no account books. There is no documentation whatsoever that will tell you anything about why a villa developed. Some of you will have followed Time Team's big Roman dig years ago at Dinnington. And, you know, it was all very impressive, wasn't it? Bits of mosaic floors. Absolutely nothing whatsoever turned up to tell us about who lived there, why they lived there, how they earned their money, what the history of that estate was. Villas just don't produce that sort of information. And it's really all you're going to do is to find a ground plan of the building, and you might be able to sequence it, and you might be able to look at the floors if there are some mosaic floors. But in most cases, you'll have absolutely no idea. Some of you will be aware of the villa recently that's been excavated in Rutland that's produced a most impressive floor with panels depicting scenes from the Trojan War. Well, that's great, and that's all very well and good, and you can speculate all you like, but no one has the slightest idea who lived there or why they installed that floor. And because that floor is unique, there's really nothing more to be said. You can waffle on about it all you like, but you're not going to answer the questions because villas just don't produce the information. There are occasional instances of fragmentary tombstones from the vicinity of a villa that might or might not name someone who used to live there. But actually, you can't make that connection. And even off the top of my head, I can't even think of one which is complete and that would tell you that anyway. So therefore, you're always stuck with a problem. Lullingstone, however, is a little bit different. There's much more of a story there. So just to recap, it's in northwest Kent. It's very easy to get to. It's owned by English Heritage. And the building is largely, not entirely, but is largely exposed under a modern cover building. And that makes it quite, right from the start, much more accessible than almost any other Roman villa in Britain. The Well, over 1,000 such buildings have been found. And the word villa is a bit of a misnomer. It means farm, but it's always applied generically to Roman houses in the country. And of course, it makes things often sound a bit more extravagant than they are. It covers a whole range of buildings, from really quite modest rural establishments up to palatial buildings. So, you know, you can get a villa like Sparsholt in Hampshire, for example, which has one fairly reasonable geometric mosaic. And then you can go right the way up to Woodchester, which is a palace-sized villa with a huge mosaic depicting Orpheus and the animals. Let's not forget Fishbourne Roman Palace, but that's a rather different subject altogether. Fishbourne Roman Palace is bigger than all the others. It belongs to very early in the Roman period, and it was in ruins by the 3rd and 4th century. What we're really talking about with villas in Roman Britain is houses that quite often have a long history, from early in the conquest period, or certainly by the 2nd century AD, and they evolve over centuries so that they become, in some cases, only some cases, by the late 3rd and 4th century, rather more developed buildings, sometimes with elaborate and impressive mosaic floors, but very rarely associated with much else. And they clearly belong to a grand tradition in the Roman world of the showcase rural establishment. When we're talking about these more impressive buildings, do bear in mind that the majority never become particularly extravagant. Now, Roman villas in Britain are similar in some respects to house development in the United States, because land was much more available in Britain. It's far smaller population than it is today, and also because of structural, architectural, and lighting reasons, it's easier to extend buildings than to go up. So typically with Roman buildings in Britain, they will start as fairly simple rows of rooms, and then they might have a corridor added to the front, and then sometimes wings, and those are called wing corridor villas, and they're just extending all the way. Now, some villas stay like that for all their lives. Others will have those wings extended, and then they may have another wing across the top, and it becomes a courtyard villa, and sometimes a double courtyard. And that's the richer, more impressive establishments. Now, while we might be able to track that from an architectural point of view, it still doesn't really tell us anything about the people who lived there, beyond the general idea that the more impressive ones appear in the most agriculturally rich parts of the province of Britain. So, for example, in the Cotswolds and parts of the Midlands, in bits of Kent, along the northern part of Kent, not mostly in the rest of Kent, because that was filled with forest. And they clearly, therefore, reflect availability of very productive land. It's not usually possible in any sense to track the estates that they controlled, other than where these might be preserved in parish boundaries, but there's nothing to prove that, so you can't really make that connection. They evidently benefit from development on into the 4th century, a time when you see very little investment in public buildings, for example, in Roman towns. And it does look as if the elite in Roman Britain are beginning to transfer, whoever they were, beginning to transfer their money into showcase rural establishments. And it may be that those became the centres of their patronage and power. Lullingstone is really atypical, actually, because of the location, which is between the River Darrenth and a hill slope. The villa never really becomes that large. It seems to go back to the 1st century AD. And that's certain. And it may have had, and sometimes this is demonstrably the case, it may have had an Iron Age forebear. But again, it is impossible ever to say whether you're looking at the descendants of those Iron Age peoples going Roman, or whether the site has been taken over by a Romanized provincial of whoever that might be, whether that's an immigrant coming in who might have been a civilian, or possibly a retired soldier. Essentially, it's impossible ever to answer that question. In Lullingstone's case, the physical location means that the house goes through a number of phases and extensions, but without really becoming that large. Now, Lullingstone was, there seems to have been, a fence was built across it in the 18th century. And there's no doubt about the fact that some of the mosaic was found at that stage, because it was damaged by the fence posts. It was first identified as a Roman building in a formal sense before the Second World War, but the war meant that the excavations couldn't take place. And it wasn't until the late 1940s 1940s and 1950s that the building was uncovered. And it produced really some quite remarkable elements of its development and history, although it remains anonymous. The building today, which is under a cover building, has a number of subterranean features that include basically the deep room. This is a large room that seems to have formed some sort of shrine, and that's on the northern end of the building, and it still has a little niche in the wall with a couple of water nymphs, but there's no inscription to that effect. It had baths on the southern end, and it seems to have lasted right up in roughly that form into the 3rd century. Now, one of the most interesting things is something that got left behind. The house appears to have been unoccupied for a period during the 3rd century. That's not entirely clear. But whoever moved in found a couple of very extravagant Mediterranean marble busts of high-status Romans. And these busts were installed in the deep room and cut off from the house. Now, it looks as if somebody moving in had found ancestor busts. I can't tell you how rare these things are. I mean, there's no other instance of anything like this in Britain. These busts, which were damaged, were buried down there, and although they seem to have been visited in some way in terms of being given offerings, they'd clearly been put away out of sight. So it does look as if somebody had moved in, found these ancestor busts, didn't want to destroy or insult them, but put them away in a safe place. So the busts, which are now in the British Museum, although there are plaster cast copies at the villa itself, they're really very striking. The more damaged one bears a very close resemblance to a man called Pertinax, who became a Roman emperor briefly after the murder of Commodus. Commodus was murdered on the last day of 192. Pertinax lasted about 3 months. He was a stickler for discipline, an old soldier, and he was then murdered by the Praetorian Guard in Rome because he tried to reform all their carrying on. They'd become very decadent, very indulgent, very lazy. The thing about Pertinax is, though, that he used to be a governor of the province of Britain. So why is there a bust of probably Pertinax at Lullingstone? Well, Lullingstone is not that far from London, and it's also not far from the main Roman road that runs through the north of Kent, Watling Street, down to the port at Dover. So it is a legitimate speculation to suggest that Lullingstone was, at least for a period of time, occupied maybe as a summer residence or used as a getaway retreat by the governor of the province of Britain, Pertinax. Possibly. Don't take my word for that, because there is no way of proving that, but the busts are so unusual that it is a matter of interest. Lullingstone also has a temple mausoleum, which I think belongs to the late 3rd century, and this was built very close to the house. It contained the bodies of a young couple, apparently male and female. Their relationship is unknown. Their cause of death is unknown. Their names are unknown. But the building is very unusual. A number of grave goods, for example, gaming pieces, were found in there. The female body, I think, was almost entirely destroyed by later grave robbers, but the male body partially survives with his lead coffin, and that is on display at the villa. Whether they represent a family tragedy or not, well, I suppose they must have done. We know nothing about it, but the inclusion of the Temple of Mausoleum is most unusual. The excavator, I should point out, incidentally, was somebody called Lieutenant Colonel G.W. or Colonel G.W. Meats. I think that's right. It is Lieutenant Colonel. There we are, G.W. Meats. And he produced this popular book about Lullingstone back in the 1960s. And this was sort of really ongoing. There's one of the busts, not the Pertinax bust, I might point out, but that is the probable Pertinax bust there. And actually, a funny thing I will just throw in, this is a copy of a textbook of Samian ware called Central Gaulish Potters, very rare, quite valuable, and this used to be Colonel Meats's copy, Lieutenant Colonel Meats's copy, which I bought, nearly 40 years ago. So there we are, and he produced a publication of the site a number of years ago. That's the building itself, and he also was followed, I think, posthumously by a book about the finds. These are both quite rare, difficult to get hold of today. Now let's take the villa on into the 4th century. By the middle of the 4th century, the villa has gone through a kind of renaissance, if you like. This is a house that is now, gosh, at least 250 years old. It's now in an era, the 4th century, the so-called golden age of Roman Britain. It was an unstable period in Romano-British history. The whole Roman world. The world is now ruled, the Roman world is now a Christian world, as of Constantine the Great, with the Edict of Toleration, which he issued in the early 4th century. Now high status people in the Roman world generally have to be Christian if they want to get on, apart from the brief restoration of paganism during the reign of Julian the Apostate. Now, what is really startling about Lullingstone during this phase is the acquisition of its mosaics. And I will put pictures of these up at the end of the villa. But it's a large panel, a double panel really, and it's been stuck into the side of the house, with on the west side of the house, an apse has been stuck in, and to include this, which I'll talk about in just a minute, this large panel here shows Bellerophon killing the Chimera, surrounded by the four seasons, and Bellerophon killing the Chimera is a sign, a symbol of good triumphing over evil. It's an allegorical scene, and some people think that that might have had Christian connections, and you'll see why in Lullingstone's terms in just a second. Next to it is this panel, which is most unusual. It shows Europa being carried by Jupiter in the guise of a bull. And very unusually, it has a Latin inscription above it. And this is one of the most interesting features of Lullingstone. And I will read to you what that says. It says, Invidus si tauri videsit uno natatus, justius Aeolius, isit edusque domus. It's in rhyming metre. It's in the style of the Roman poet Ovid, but it famously alludes to a scene in Book 1 of Vergil's Aeneid. Now, the truth is that Juno... Well, I'll read you the passage from my book, The Real Lives of Roman Britain. Juno, queen of the gods, loather of Trojans and supporter of the Carthaginians, is disgusted at the thought that a Trojan prince, that's Aeneas, is on his way to establish a future race of Romans who will destroy the Carthaginians. So she appeals to Aeolus, god of the winds, to blow Aeneas off course and drown him. The Lullingstone couplet means, if jealous Juno had seen the swimming of the bull, she could have gone as far as the halls of Aeolus with more justice. Or in other words, Aeolus's winds would have been better utilised by Juno in putting her unfaithful husband Jupiter off course, he was running off with Europa, than by trying to thwart Aeneas. It doesn't come from any known poem. It's a very good example, although it's unique, of something that happened quite a lot in the Roman world. It went right the way back to earlier classical times, when affluent, typically male Romans, would show off their learning, their literary knowledge with readings. They would often showcase their own work by trying to write things in the style of more famous poets. It's clearly linked to all of that. And in the 4th century in Roman Britain, you seem to get a strange provincial revival of that habit. Whether it's elite Romano-British people who are trying to ape their classical forebears, trying to recreate that in Britain, we don't know. Of course, there is an interesting link to the Roman rebel emperor Carausius in the late 3rd century, who had undoubtedly alluded to Vergil on his coins, including references to the 4th eclogue and also Vergil's 4th eclogue and also to Vergil's Aeneid. And he could only have done that if he knew that the people he was trying to sell himself to were familiar with those classical texts. So, you know, this is part of Roman education and learning, and here we see it in Britain in the 4th century. And it's just extraordinary, you know, to go to Eynsford, drive down the narrow lane all the way to the end where Lullingstone Roman Villa is located, pay your money and in you go, and there is this Latin couplet on a mosaic floor in the cover building in Lullingstone. Some people believe it contains hidden messages. I don't think that's very convincing at all. You can almost make up anything by trying to sort of count through the letters. It's very easy to do so. And I don't find that plausible at all. That's Lullingstone Roman Villa around the year 360. So we're coming towards the end of the Romano-British period, but there was another remarkable chapter to take place at Lullingstone. Incidentally, the mosaics are still there in the villa. They haven't been moved. Towards the end of the 4th century, a house church was installed in Lullingstone, or so that appears. Very careful excavation of the deep room and associated structures showed that upper rooms had collapsed down and their wall plaster had fallen into the rooms. And the result was that a very careful recreating it showed that the Cairo, the Alpha and the Omega, and this of course is the key Christian sign, the Greek first two Greek letters of the name of Christ. There's no parallel for this at all, although we know that house churches existed at that time in the Roman world. Churches were not that common. It was more likely that Christian communities would meet in churches and a visiting itinerant priest would come and hold services. There's also a painting from the villa that shows the Christian worshippers with their hands upraised, and that's how early Christians worshipped. We know nothing about who these people were, and the rooms involved seem to have been self-contained in the sense that they were accessible from outside but not from within the building. Not really clear what was going on there. In the early 5th century, the Roman government of Britain was given up, and while that by no means meant that Roman life disappeared overnight, it did mean that the services and support systems and economy that made villas viable began to dissipate. And as a result, Lullingstone, like most villas, fell into disrepair. And because of the hill slope that's behind it, that did slip down over the building and eventually buried it. Now, of course, that also helped to preserve it, which is one of the miracles of Lullingstone. And it was Meats's exceptionally careful excavation and the various other archaeologists who worked with him that have made it such an extraordinarily valuable and interesting place. The wall paintings depicting the Christian Cairo and the worshippers are to be found in the British Museum, just a few feet away from the marble busts. Lullingstone's story, however, was not entirely over. I mentioned that there was the temple mausoleum. There was also another circular building and also a large barn. You can't see most of those today. The barn is actually under the approach road to the car park. And nor can you see the temple mausoleum. But by the 18th century, an engraving was produced of a Saxon church of Lullingstone that seems to have sat on top of the temple mausoleum. Now, that's long gone. It's been destroyed. It does, however, to me, suggest a folk memory had existed on into the Saxon period of Christian worship at Lullingstone. That's why the church was built there in the Saxon period, after St. Augustine came and Christianity returned to Britain. And in a modest sort of way, you do have a kind of carry-on from the Roman period right the way up to early modern times. And it's probable the house was completely buried and the people who built the church probably selected the site of the temple mausoleum, believing that that in some way was connected with the Christian worship. So there it is. That's Lullingstone. It's open, as far as I know, all year round, but you always have to check the English Heritage website to visit it. If you're coming to Britain from abroad, it's relatively easy to get to from London. It is one of very few Roman villas in the country, and while I don't want in any sense to disparage the others, for example, the magnificent site at Chedworth, for example, in Gloucestershire, Lullingstone is, to my mind, by far and away the Roman villa in Britain with a unique and genuinely interesting story, even if it is tantalisingly fragmented and lacking in key information that would enable us to know more about it. I go back to something I said earlier. The reality is you can dig all you like on a Roman villa. It is not going to yield most of the answers to the questions you are putting towards it. And I've never seen a Roman villa excavation come up with those answers. In Lullingstone's case, though, you get a little bit closer. And because it's open to the public and easily accessible, and you can see the whole building, I would recommend that you go and visit it. It's one of those places that, I would have said as a child, visiting it, it was a turning point for me. It resulted in a lifelong fascination with the place with Roman Britain. And in that sense, it has never been supplanted. Regardless of all the things that have been found since, Lullingstone will always have a special place in my heart, a place, a Roman villa, the home once to all sorts of people whose names we will never know, whose lives took paths we will never know about, but that doesn't mean for a minute that it doesn't represent a fascinating example of a place that was once a home, had its own story, and you can still go and see that today. So now what's going to follow are some pictures of the site that you can have a look through, and I hope very much that you get the chance to go and visit Lullingstone yourself one day, if you haven't already.